Over the past 6 months, I've been working intensively on the geometry of the extruder tube. It was a time of many frustrating moments as I had to abandon or at least adapt some of my ideas about what happens inside the tube. When experimenting, the rule is only change one parameter at a time, which, when testing hardware, meant I had to create a lot of extruder tubes, only a few of which are shown here. One misconception, for example, was that shorter is better, because shorter means less overall friction and thus less force that the extruder screw has to overcome. Versions with a very short heat barrier, however, led to severe clogging of the tube after some time of printing. During printing, the varying back pressure causes liquid material to be forced upwards. If the transition from liquid to solid is very short, the plastic solidifies on the cold upper wall, sticking the screw and tube together, blocking the whole extruder. Also making the water cooling system flatter so that at least the cold end could be kept shorter didn't work as expected either. Extrusion creates very high friction even in the relatively small extruder tube. Models with a soft-soldered connection between the tube and the metal plate of the water cooling system occasionally leaked because the solder joint cracked. The friction between screw and plastic generates a noticeable portion of heat even in the upper part of the tube, the cold end, which should actually be cold. If the plastic softens in this area, the screw can no longer grip the material and push it downwards effectively. As a result, the material feed drops significantly after printing only a few layers. I also set myself the goal of building the next version of the extruder tube from one part instead of three. The starting part is an M6 threaded sleeve made of stainless steel. Stainless steel has a lower thermal conductivity than regular steel, which is advantageous for low heat flow from the hot end to the cold end. However, the material's higher hardness is a disadvantage when machining with my cheap lathe. When drilling out the internal thread, grooves are created in a radial direction. It makes no significant difference whether I drill directly to the final diameter or proceed in stages. On the tube shown here, I drilled directly to the final diameter of 8.5mm. The internal thread causes the cutting edge of the drill bit to wobble around, which leaves grooves on the walls. With the extra long drill bit, the wobbling is clearly visible. If you drill in stages, the grooves look slightly different, but they still interfere with the plastic's flow through the tube. Okay, if smooth drilling isn't possible with my machinery, then I just take a purchased stainless steel tube and solder a piece with an M6 thread for the nozzle onto the bottom. But that didn't work either because the inside isn't perfectly smooth. So I used a brass tube, a long one to limit the heat flow to the cold end. After all, previous extruders made mainly of this material have worked well. But that wasn't really a success either. The tube has to be really long because brass has a thermal conductivity coefficient that is more than 6 times higher than that of stainless steel. Such a long tube in turn creates too high mechanical friction during extrusion. Since this year's maker fair was just around the corner, I quickly solved the problem by gluing a Teflon tube into the drilled out threaded sleeve so I could conduct print tests. On my first attempt, I again encountered the problem that the material feed stopped after just a few layers. The problem here is that the friction is simply too low because resistance in radial direction is needed to prevent the plastic from rotating with the screw. With that, the screw can't push the plastic. The solution was to cut out about a quarter of a Teflon tube with 10mm outer and 8mm inner diameter. If this is compressed and glued into the 8.5mm hole, a gap of about 2-3mm remains. This groove ensures that the movement of the plastic is at least reduced in radial direction, while the friction in the axial direction of the tube remains sufficiently low. Since I never go to fairs without spare parts, I built 3 identical extruders, and all of them work perfectly with a 6mm diameter wood screw. In brief tests regarding the volumetric throughput I was able to work at a speed of 120mm per second with an extrusion width of 0.5mm and a layer height of 0.2mm. I used a 0.5mm nozzle, my standard for printing with a granule extruder so far. The achievable precision is also quite good. This robot called Makey is printed in one piece with internal joints and all the hinges move once removed from the print bed. As giveaways at Maker Faire I printed small versions of the mascot out of PLA on site. Version 6.0 of the extruder worked flawlessly during the 2 days, so I didn't need a single spare part. I didn't even have to complain about a clogged nozzle. In the days before I drove to Hannover I printed some PLA parts for the Maker Faire using this configuration and I didn't encounter any problems. All of the parts shown here were printed with the Teflon inserts, I only had to replace it once. On the large Benji upon closer inspection you can see small gaps in the upper part of the cabin which prompted me to replace one tube. In addition to mechanical wear, the temperature limit of the Teflon insert is a problem that I'll address next. Plan A is to smoothen the inside of the tube with a reamer or by sanding and polishing, possibly electropolishing. Plan B is enamel coating. Further down on my list are inserts made of other materials, perhaps a stack of different tubes on the inside, there's still a lot to experiment with. If you'd like to support my efforts with a financial injection, my website has a donate button in addition to the 3D files and the build instructions. Many thanks to everyone who has already made use of this button to send me an Obol, a special thanks again to my anonymous major sponsor. Thanks for watching and I'll be back.